I'm going again back to the safe practice of medicine, not because I want to repeat Elizabeth, but because I wanted to remind everybody that safe practice of medicine means that we know our stuff. We know what we need to know. We know how to resuscitate a person. But is that enough? The answer is no. It has been answered by Elizabeth already, so I will not answer it again. But what we need to remember is that effective skill communication, effective communication is important, because at the end of the day, it's not this lady who matters, it's not this lady who matters, it's this man who matters. So now we have changed from the old school where we were gods to, hey, we are a team of people working towards a common goal where the center is the patient. And Elizabeth has said it very, very elegantly by saying the word non-technical skills. And in reality, those are non-technical skills and not human factors as we used to call them, because human factors in reality is an umbrella term. But are these really non-technical skills? Since 70%, and I'm quoting Elizabeth again here, since 70% of the errors are rooted back to those communication skills, maybe we should, it's time for us to change and think of these non-technical skills rather than as essential skills, as important skills. And this is why we are bound as educators, we are bound as healthcare providers to teach them and throughout our practice. All these were happening, and all these were happening into the era before the COVID pandemic. We were very comfortable with our learning theories. We were very comfortable with our traditional format of our lectures. Not the ideal situation, but lectures were still there. We were very comfortable with problem-based learning or team-based learning. And, oops, I'm sorry, I don't know what happened. With problem-based learning and team-based learning, project-based learning, with their own differences. I'm not going to go into detail now because this is not the aim of what I wanted to say, but we were very, very comfortable because we had technology on our side, and we also had the physical presence on our side. We also had our learning spaces. Now, how do we define a learning space? Well, a learning space is literally a space where learning can occur, any type of space. And we were very happy about our learning spaces because our learning spaces could be dynamic, innovative, encourage simulation, encourage imagination, and as a result, lead to what we call construction of knowledge, the idea of constructivism in medical education. And we also knew that our students were no longer children. And as a result, we knew that we needed to engage them in the learning process. It was Knowles, several years ago, who defined the difference of pedagogy as andragogy. And the Knowles principles of andragogy is involve the adult learner, use the experience of the adult learner in order to make your own point, say the relevance of why it is important for you to teach the problem, and then create the problem for the adult to learn. All those had extremely good effects in our everyday teaching. We had amazing simulators, and we had several serious papers like this one, where it was actually showing how simulation can improve the outcome of the anatomy of a curriculum, or for example, how full mission simulation with these fancy, amazing rooms where you've got an intensive care, an operating theater room, along with a control room, you could actually build even guide even first year medical students to learn simple things like the cardiovascular function curves, or how to use second year use students to learn something that I needed to do an MSc, to tell you the truth, in order to understand, which is toxicology. But and these people were extremely satisfied. The participants in these courses, in the traditional way, where the physical presence was there, they were pretty satisfied. We were pretty satisfied because we thought that we were doing our best in order to learn through the learning process, not only teach our students, but also self-reflect on what we were doing and improve ourselves. And then when we were in our comfort zone, and I remember all of us sitting back and discussing about future collaboration and how we're going to go ahead with all those amazing initiatives in simulation, virtual things, then the coronavirus hit. And then we were thrown away of our comfort zone. And this was actually shown in several papers, several white papers at the beginning, where it said, you know, COVID-19 is changing medical education. And apparently the change that COVID-19 has done on medical education, as I'm going to explain in a little while, is probably here to stay and not here to go. So suddenly the physical presence was not allowed. The student and us, we had to work mostly remotely from our homes. This made the problems a little bit different, because we knew how to use the online tools in order to deliver part of our classes online and virtually. And everybody is very well aware about the massive online, and I'm going to discuss about those programs that were delivered online. But on the other hand, at the level of the undergraduate student, we always had the feeling of the physical presence, where the person interacted with the educator, and the educator became a role model, not only because of the way he would look on a screen like I do now, but the way he was smiling, behaving in his everyday life, something that's missing nowadays. And as a result, new things came into our reality. And again, as we heard before from Elizabeth, things do not start from medicine. Medicine adopts many things, but things do not necessarily start from medicine. In medicine, we have learned about the different educational theories, and we know them very well: constructivism, behaviorism, zone of proximal development, and stuff like that. However, it's only the last 4 years that connectivism came into place. And connectivism did not start by medicine, but it started by the IT technologists. And in reality, this idea started from the fact that the majority of the new learners on internet, the so-called Generation Y, are more interested in the method of delivery than the material of what we have to say. So they were more interested in the medium of the delivery, so the computers, the virtual environment, rather than the material that we had to deliver through that. For connectivism, knowledge is unpredictable. And why is knowledge unpredictable? Because in reality, no one can control knowledge. So since knowledge cannot be controlled, And it's in a continuous growth. As a result, knowledge goes beyond one person and it lies in the rest of external networks, such as communities, digital devices, in order to be transmitted and effectively communicated with the students. And I'm still telling you that up to this point, connectivism was only used for the IT technology only. It had nothing to do with medicine. For those of us who know a little bit of theory behind the medical education theories, we can see that connectivism and the Gestalt psychology, they do share some similarities. So in both theoretical schools, knowledge is dependent on the global view generated by knowledge itself. However, knowledge is less important than the view according to the circumstances in connectivism as compared to the Gestalt theory. Connectivism and constructivism. I used to define myself as a constructivist before because I felt that I cannot passively pass what's in my mind into my students' minds. So I needed to allow them to construct their own knowledge. And in reality, connectivism and constructivism appear to have a few things in common. And we are still not at the medical education era. Those are very general observations at the beginning. So in reality, what are we doing with constructivism and the various type of constructivism is that we allow the student to go through, use their senses, their social interactions, and then create their own constructs of knowledge, and as a result, maintain knowledge for a longer time. The connectivist learning model says that, well, actually the same thing happens. But this time, it's not the senses that we are using, it's actually the media. And the medium is an electronic medium. So, both theories believe that the ability to increase knowledge is more important than what we already know, because what we know, but what we need to know is much more important than what we already know, and most important is what we don't know. And this is why constructivism and connectivism share, but on the other hand, they've got a significant difference. Constructivism says that once a construct has been created, it's very difficult to change. Connectivism says exactly the opposite. With the massive amount of information that we are getting through all those online tools, all those virtual environments that we are using up to now, the construct of knowledge is changing all the time. Our conception of what we know changes all the time. So knowledge is no longer a block, but it's rather a fluid that runs within us. So we are constantly constructing new knowledge as we are constantly making connections. And this is why this webinar is a great success, because in reality, it's using connectivism to enhance people making connections, social connections. And the important thing is that we all knew about the communities of practice, where the communities of practice in reality was nothing more than the fact that people share the same idea, the same vocabularies, and they spontaneously came together with a common vision in order to change something, to a more important thing, a stronger thing, which is the collective mentality. Because the collective mentality, in reality, relies on the social network, the learning. And now we know, as years went by with the ideas using connectivism and medicine having to use connectivism in order to deliver its curriculum, that the social networking, network learning is much more important than the learning in the communities of practice. And here's just an example of the community of practice, but imagine that these small communities of practice all connect together through a medium and create something bigger than this community of practice. And as a result, the knowledge that we learn is constantly updated and upgraded. Elizabeth spoke about teams. The same thing happens in connectivism. We do have teams, but here, teams have a little bit a very different meaning, where we have cooperation, collaboration, the process, the lessons. Unfortunately, we don't have the face-to-face. And sometimes the setting of the work is very, very different from what we were used to do until now. And as a result, the teams are in reality networks of people who are working remotely, yet they share their values of communities of practice. And just a few papers to highlight what I've just said about the theoretical framework and how connectivism was initially used for the Internet of Things and the interrelation of computer clouding. And you can see here that the problem were mainly the medium and not the knowledge itself. But on the other hand, we see new publications of 2020 speaking about the online learning environments in higher education, where connectivism plays an important role. Four people that I tend to know very well, they started this initiative, the Task Oriented Connectivist MOOC. And these people launched the MOOCs. Now the MOOCs are everywhere. Coursera is full of them. Several organizations are full of them. But in reality, what MOOCs did was nothing less than the values of connectivism. So medical education used these ideas, and not only in Europe, but also in other parts of the world, where in reality, they used the ideas of connectivism in order to design new learning models. Now, what technologies can we use in medical education? Unlimited. There is no technology that cannot be used with a medium of connectivism. A few things here, but in reality, everything you can imagine can be done through the medium. The only thing that we need to remember as a medical educator regarding connectivism is that you cannot control the knowledge you are giving to your students. And why did I say that the COVID era may change medical education forever? Because as medical educators, we want to become better. And what is better and what is excellent? And I want to quote an ancient Greek philosopher who said that, you know, being excellent is not a momentary act. It's not something that happens once and you receive an A. It's a way of living. It's a way of thinking, it's a way of behavior. So there is no primacy in the production of excellence. And remember that all of us as medical educators, we need to have all the qualities of a leader. So we need to collaborate, we need to communicate, we need to be the health advocate, we need to be a professional, we need to be a researcher, and we need to use whatever we have available at our disposal in order to deliver the message to our student students, which is finally professionalism. Thank you.